You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Come in store and you'll also get a 10-day sample of Double Wear Longwear Foundation in your perfect shade. Quantities are limited, so don't miss the Estee Lauder free gift. Now through August 23rd at Dillard's and Dillard's.com.
Sometimes we need to slow down and remember the simple pleasures in life. Good coffee, good books, and good company. Come on in. Take a seat. The coffee's just been brewed. Let's see who we have in the coffee shop today.
What a wonderful day in the coffee shop. And as always, I'm looking for a book. The book on the table. There's a book. And the title of it is Feeding Frenzy. And the author's name is Maaja Wentz. How you doing today, Maaja?
Oh, great, Jesse. Thank you.
You've got to tell me about Feeding Frenzy.
Okay, so Feeding Frenzy is the story of a young woman who starts university. She wants to reinvent herself. She's looking for her world to open out. But what happens is her family has some dark secrets, and her university campus is overrun by a deadly eating epidemic. And the more she looks into it, the more she realizes that her family past that she's trying to escape is responsible. So to survive, she has to develop magical abilities she didn't realize she had. And she has to uncover a conspiracy that involves her aunt.
Wow, that sounds fantastically intriguing.
Yeah, it was actually a blast to write. It's got digital ninjas and necromancers and people's hair changing color, and I had so much fun writing the scenes in the cemetery with people just eating straight out of tubs of lard with their hands.
Okay, I've got to ask, how do you research a necromancer?
Okay, so I'll be honest here. I read a lot of Harry Potter and I made it up. I really am not one of those people who are interested in the deep occult. I'm really kind of a cheerful person. So this book is really not, going to lead anyone into terrible temptation, no, except for the food part.
Hey, if they're eating s'mores or chocolate eclairs, I'm right there.
Okay.
I'll take a pass on the lard, though.
Yeah.
So what made you decide to write this, for lack of a term, coming-of-age story? Was it the story that came to you, or what made you decide to tell this tale?
Okay, so that's a bit of a long story. I was kind of in a funk. I had been writing for a while, and I had joined critique groups, and I was writing lots of short stories, and I'd written several novel manuscripts, but I wasn't sending them out to agents or editors or anything. And I realized I was suffering from kind of submission anxiety. My critique group loved the stories, but I would send it out to an anthology or a contest, and if people didn't buy it or give it a prize right away, I might not send it out again. And publishing is kind of a numbers game, so you can't have that attitude and win. So what I did was I started to serialize the story on Wattpad. So in a way, I deliberately sat down and decided that I would write something that would be fun to read as a serial. Every week, people would get one chapter. There's a lot of cliffhangers and reveals at the end of chapters. You know, the kind of things that keep people turning pages are the same kind of things that would make someone want to go back to the Wattpad website and read the story. So I just thought, you know what, I'll write something that's fun And my whole goal was to make people get to the end of the chapter and go, oh, no, she didn't. Oh, yes, she did. And so that's why it's got witches and magic and necromancers. And I got to think about my first year at university. So it was a bit nostalgic for me, but also fun to imagine what it would be like to have magic in your first year of university.
That sounds fantastic. It really does. So what was your favorite university memory that made its way in some form into the book?
Oh my gosh. Okay, so there's a huge, for want of a better word, food fight in the cafeteria at the height of the frenzy, and people are walking around like food-crazed zombies. But I studied English and French literature, and I'm a fan of an author called François Rabelais, and he wrote a book called Gargantua and another called Pantagruel, and they're about giants. But they're also a social commentary. And so at one point, he's got a giant war scene on a battlefield. But in microcosm, he's got cake bakers facing off against like a different kind of food preparation. And they're like throwing food at each other, and they're using, you know, ladles as weapons. And so you could say that this is inspired by a book that I read in university.
Oh, that's great. It really is. I always love to find out what made you write the story, because that's one of those things I think every reader wants to know. Now,
yeah,
this is one book in a series.
Yeah, it's the first. I mean, it reads like a complete story, but I want to go back to Loon Lake, this magic little town with, you know, power that comes out of the cemetery and unpredictable events. And my next book is a little different because there's going to be dragons.
Okay, so how are you going to research the dragons?
Well, here's what I like about writing fantasy. If you read a lot of fantasy, you can just make things that are kind of your own flavor. So I didn't research real dragons because there are no real. And let's just say that I have a more scientific view of dragons because I'm also a science fiction fan. So on the one hand, I get to get away with all sorts of magic stuff because it's fantasy. But on the other hand, I've been inspired by, shall we say, the habits of certain parasitic wasps.
That sounds absolutely fantastic. Parasitic wasps.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't want to go into any more of the details because book two and book three are still in, like, I'm editing book two right now. So things can change a lot. For example, I think I'm changing the narrative. So it's much more of a murder mystery for the second one. More thriller, more mystery, but still with all the fun urban fantasy magic.
Sounds like a great read. By the way, I love repeat coffee shop guests too.
Okay, I'm up for it.
So what made you decide to take this coming-of-age story and throw in the sci-fi fantasy twists? Was it just to make it more fun? And you mentioned Harry Potter. Unlike the world of Harry Potter, where they get their, you know, their magical powers at a young age, in this case, your protagonist doesn't get her magical powers until she's in university.
Yeah, well, there's a whole story behind that as well. Like in Loon Lake, the magic is really local and it comes from living there. So because the people since the, you know, the beginning of their settlement in Loon Lake, because magic has always been there, they have ways of coping with it. And so there's factions in their society. There's the mods who want to take a modern approach and use magic, even to do things like make money or forward themselves in their profession. There's the trads who take a traditional approach, who don't believe that any magic should be used in front of mundanes. Those would be non-magical outsiders. And then there's the pures. And Tanya's family is pure, which means they have the ability to use magic, but they're not supposed to use it at all. And so, you know, one of the things that happens to her is she grows up kind of an outcast because most people were either mods or trads. So it was very hard for her even just making friends growing up. So when she goes to university, she wants to go to University of Toronto in a big city and leave all this magic and, you know, small town, small city politics behind. But she can't because her parents force her to go to that university and they won't explain why. And then they disappear.
Oh, wow. So we have a parental disappearance and a kid who doesn't want to use magic forced into using it.
Yeah, it's definitely a tricky situation for Tanya because she also has this rebellious aunt who just won't follow the rules and won't really even pick a side. She has something called the Herbal Healing Shop, and she will sell charms to people. Sometimes she'll even sell charms to mundanes, which is what they call people who don't use magic. And the interesting thing about this town for me is the idea that in this little town, you have all these people who use magic coexisting with people who don't, because it's, you know, it's a small city.
That sounds absolutely fantastic. So is Loon Lake based on a real place?
Okay, so it isn't a real place, but this is where I did the most research. Near Toronto, there's a city named Peterborough, which is a lovely university town on a river. And what I did was I looked at Peterborough, partly because it's got a fantastic cemetery. I went through the cemetery and I filmed it. And I walked it, and I visited Peterborough. I mean, I visited Peterborough as a child as well. It's not that far from where my parents have a cottage. So the setting of Loon Lake is kind of Balsam Lake, which is a beautiful lake in the Kawarthas, which is another place near Toronto, and Peterborough. Which doesn't have a big lake in the middle of it. It has a river running through. And so I took a bit of both places. But my story is also has a big influence from my travels to Peru, because one of the characters is kind of a fish out of water. His name is Roberto. He comes from a magic-using family in Peru. He's a rich kid, kind of spoiled from private school, and he comes to Loon Lake and is not impressed with how the Canadians are living. So we kind of get an outsider view as well. And he's also part of the plot because his parents send him there with an agenda.
Oh boy, so he has an agenda.
He has an agenda and he's not necessarily happy about it. He is angry at his parents because he wanted them to send him somewhere nice like California. But instead, he's in southern Ontario where winters are snowy and cold. And for a boy from a rich family in Peru, this is just not a nice thing to do.
Doesn't sound like a very nice thing to do, to stick your kid in a small town and just kind of... drop him there and say, you have to do this. Bye.
Yeah. Yeah, he's on a mission. His mission is to figure out what the source of magic is and grab as much of it for the family as he possibly can.
Okay, so how do you grab magic?
I think that would be a spoiler, but
it's possible in your world.
His parents don't know what's possible when they send him because magic works in a lot of slippery and unpredictable ways in my world.
Okay. That's totally allowable because guess what? It's fiction.
I know. It's very much fiction. Yes. It's funny. I'm a teacher librarian and I've had kids ask me, you know, do you believe in magic? Not that I would ever talk about my book to kids, because it's really, I think the readership for this is more adults to, you know, older teens and, you know, university age. But I've had students ask me, do you believe in magic? No, I don't. That's why I can have so much fun with it.
Wow. Are you ever worried that any of these kids will find your writings and come back and say, but you wrote magic?
No, because, you know, I can always point to Harry Potter. Nobody believes in the Harry Potter magic.
Okay, that's great. Although I think all of us love to be transported to that other world while we're reading and just slip into the pages and get carried away.
Oh, exactly. Exactly. I mean, part of writing is a little bit of that escapism that you get when you're reading, because you have this town, these characters, this way of existence that's so far away from the daily grind, and you can just make magical, wonderful, surprising things.
Now, I have to ask, are you one of those people that plots out your books, or do you let your characters run away with the story?
Are you familiar with No Plan Survives Contact with the Enemy?
Yes,
I try to plan. But here's what happens. So I have a very good idea of my characters, and I plan some of the main events that I would like to happen. But when I start writing it, that isn't necessarily what happens. I mean, I wrote this book by getting up at 5 a.m. and writing for an hour and a half every day for 30 days. Very deliberately. And then I posted it on Wattpad by polishing one chapter a week, posting it on Wattpad, and letting my followers and readers on Wattpad read it. So the first draft was written very quickly, and it got away from the outline. And then as I was polishing the chapters and putting them on Wattpad, the story changed again. I had not reached the end in the rough draft when I started posting chapters. So I had a long time to think about how I wanted it to end and how I wanted the events in the story to build up to that ending. I'm really happy that the climax is not an empty climax. It's really a big scene. And I think writing it over the course of such a long time really helped me do that, because it's my first novel. And, having from 2015, October 31st, when I posted the very first chapter on Wattpad, until I just launched it in March of 2018, I've had time to change it, reshape it, and make it a very different story than a bare bones outline.
That's great. So it sounds like you plot out the main points and then kind of let your characters, like you want your main character to go to university, you want this to happen, you want that to happen, but how you're going to get from A to B and B to C, you let your characters run away with.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. The characters can change the plot entirely. And the other thing is, I did a lot of my world building, which is, deciding on exactly what the town is like geographically and how the magic works in that story. Those were actually things that I had to look at again in revision, because I had let the characters lead and the story lead, and then I had to go back and make sure everything was consistent.
That's great. That's great. So was it hard to maintain that consistency?
I think people who plan very tightly and keep to their plan don't have a problem with that. But for me, writing is a much more organic thing. A lot of the time, if I write a short story, I'll just sit down, start writing, and write the whole short story, and there was no plan. But a novel is a much bigger beast. So, yeah, I've lost your question a little bit, but you have to fight for consistency when something is as big as a novel.
I could see that, because I know even sometimes doing my own show, and more with my other show than this one, sometimes I will go running down a rabbit trail I didn't intend to run down that has very little to do with what I said the show was going to cover. So I've been down that chaos.
Yeah. And the other thing about consistency is I literally wrote the first draft of book two and the first draft of book three while I was editing the first book, because there was a lot of time lag between, for example, when my editor had time slots and she was available. She's a very good award-winning editor, Sandra Kasturi, who is also running her own publishing company. And so in order to have an editor that good, there was time delays, and they were really worth it, but I didn't want to waste my time in between. So I wrote the second book and the third book. And by the time I got to the third book, there were interesting things that I could add to the continuity of the whole trilogy, if you like, while I was still editing the first one. So that was probably something unique. I think most people write their first book, they edit their first book, they publish their first book, and then they start writing the second one.
Well, I have to say, when it comes to your plotting style of not, you are actually in what I would call excellent company. Well, the only author I ever name on air, and it's become my habit because they are traditionally published, but that's not why I name them. I don't want to accidentally name an author that, even though I love traditional published, I love self-published, small press, I love them all, I read them all. I only ever name Brad Thor on this show for one reason. A, he's a number one New York Times bestselling author. What a better role model. Guess what? He uses a similar plotting strategy.
Oh, wow. You know, I think a lot of what we would call literary novels are not written to a plot as well. They're written around themes. So, like, there is no one way of writing a novel. And, you know, whatever works for the person who's doing it.
I think it's all up to you. But trust me, I'm always the one that loves to reap the benefits of what you've written, because I realize, even though I'm a reader, but I am also a fan of talking to authors, and I've talked to quite a few at this point, that writing isn't an easy job. So what made you decide to go the self-published route?
Okay, yeah, that is a great question. And part of it is just the material. You know, it's an urban fantasy with magic, and I think it would have a lot of appeal to the kind of people who read urban fantasy. And urban fantasy readers love ebooks. I mean, my book is available in paperback, but I've already found that more people are reading it as an ebook than in paperback. But the other reason that I went the self-publishing route is Feeding Frenzy started out online as a serial on the Wattpad platform, which is a free reading platform. It got 141,000 reads, so I kind of realized the story had legs. I didn't realize people would like it when I started. I wrote it partly as a dare with myself to put something out there that I couldn't take back. You know, once you put something out on the internet, it's out there. And so I originally started doing that because I have more than five drawer novels, and I just wanted to kind of force myself to put something out there because I wasn't submitting to publishers. I wasn't submitting to agents. And then what happened was Wattpad chose it as a featured story. And then it won a Wattie Award. And I thought, people are enjoying this story. I should publish it. But because it had been previously published on Wattpad, I didn't think it would have any luck going the traditional route, you know, even if I wanted to do that. But the other side of that is just that when you self-publish, you have control over so many things, including the cover. And I love my cover designer. I think it's, I think she's a real artist. And, so it's been a lot of fun, actually. I'm not sure I would trade.
That's great. So you've got to tell me the story behind the cover. There's always some kind of story.
On Wattpad, I did a cover where I chose a picture of a girl looking very guilty, eating a big piece of cake. And it does get across the idea that, you know, although on Wattpad I categorized Feeding Frenzy as a mystery thriller, I wanted to show the spooky element. I wanted to show that it's lighthearted, that it's not dark fantasy. I mean, people laughed when I read one of the chapters at the book launch. People laughed. You know, this is a book that will make you smile. It's not going to depress you. So I wanted a cover that would show that it's funny. But my friends kept telling me, you know, this cover kind of makes it look like a romance novel. And although there's an element of romance, there's also an element of horror. I mean, we have a mind-controlled fungus. We have people who may or may not have been bitten by other people. So, you know, no graphic cannibalism, but there's a suggestion that people were starting to get hungry enough to consider it. So that is not a romance novel, even though, spoiler alert, it has kind of a happy ending for the heroine. But this is not something that a traditional romance reader is going to like if they don't like urban fantasy, if they don't mind a little bit of creepy horror humor. So my new cover, it's a little bit better that way because it has magic on the cover. It's less about the eating and more about the magic. And I think I looked through at least 300 pictures before I found the face of Feeding Frenzy.
That's great. It's great that you did that. I mean, I always think the cover is kind of a window into the soul of a book, for lack of a better term. So you always want to have that special cover that speaks to what's going on, but doesn't give away the whole story.
Yeah. The only thing about the cover that I think is potentially misleading is, you know, because she's a first year university student, we've got the university in the background and the moon and the kind of aura of magic. And then the cover designer. Okay, I gotta credit her, even though she's so good, I'm sure she doesn't need any more business. But her name's Heather Hamilton Center. She's lovely, and she uses kind of painting techniques to make it unique. So it doesn't just look like pictures. It's a real composition.
That's great. I mean, because you, like I said, you always want that special eye-catching piece of art on the front of your book.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So what made you to decide to pick this exact face and this exact cover? Did it just speak to you?
Yeah. You know what? There's something about her. There's kind of a determination, but also kind of an innocence. She's kind of a soft girl trying to look tough, right? she was a little bit bullied in high school, but she's come to university to reinvent herself. She wants to leave all that behind, find new friends. And for example, her best new friend is named Priya, and she's an artist. And Priya isn't on the cover of this book, but I hope she's on the cover of one of the future ones, because she becomes a more important character. But Priya's idea is she wants to make art that scares people. So there's a lot of spooky atmosphere. The book is, there's a Halloween theme running through it. A lot of the most terrible things that happen in the book are a result of the things that happened on Halloween night. So, you know, I think when you're in university, Halloween takes on a whole different aspect than it did when you were a child.
Oh, it does. There's so many different things that go on at universities that the 10-year-old who goes, knock, knock, trick or treat, it's just, it is a whole other level.
They miss out. They miss out. Even as an adult, I love Halloween. It's one of my favorite holidays because, well, really, it's just for fun. You get to wear an exciting costume and be somebody else for the night and see your friends in a different way and just kind of celebrate in a lighthearted way and have spooky good times.
I think it's great. I really do. Now, it is time to take that wonderful commercial break. So I am going to pour you a fresh cup of coffee and ask you and the listeners to hang on with us while we pay those radio station bills, and we'll see you on the other side.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
If you're 85 or younger, would you like peace of mind and comfort for your family? We're Final Expense Direct with an urgent message for you. The average funeral today costs over $8,000, but the most you'll get from government benefits is $255. How will your family pay the difference? We can help. Our senior plans start as low as just a dollar a day and pay up to $30,000 for a funeral and other final expenses. Peace of mind is easy. There's no medical exam. You'll have lifetime coverage, and your plan can't be canceled as long as you pay your premiums. Call now for free information about our senior plans. Answer a few simple questions and receive approval right on the phone. Plus, call right now, and we'll give you a discount prescription card for free. Call 800-553-8687. That's 800-553-8687. Again, 800-553-8687.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Everyone loves liberty. Our rights come from God, not the government. So why are you letting other people tell you what's best for your health care? Exercise your freedom with Liberty Health Share. Liberty Health Share is a community of people who voluntarily share one another's medical costs. Liberty Health Share is founded on the idea that most people truly want to help one another. Healthcare sharing allows members to do just that as a true community that supports one another in times of need. Liberty believes people should make decisions for themselves and their families. Members are able to take back the freedom to make their own decisions about their health care. Freedom from guilt or doubt about how your money is used. You have the the freedom to direct your health care, not to be dictated to by bureaucrats. Stop letting others tell you what to do and join a community of like-minded people. Exercise your freedom. Join Liberty HealthShare and take back the control of your health care while helping those around you. Call Liberty at 855-58-LIBERTY. Again, that's 855-58-LIBERTY for more information, or you can check them out at libertyhealthshare.org. Again, that's libertyhealthshare.org.
Sometimes riders feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. It takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our riding into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable riders to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a rider's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com.
Well, I thank all of you for hanging in there with us while we paid those radio station bills. I am going to pour myself a fresh cup of coffee for the second half of this episode. And, of course, Maaja Wentz is still with us. Now, Maaja, there is one question that escaped my mind in the first half of this episode. You mentioned Wattpad on several occasions. You want to tell the listeners who don't know what that is a little bit about it?
Sure, Jesse. Okay, so Wattpad is an online reading platform. It has something like 65 million users worldwide, and it allows writers to upload chapters of stories. And you could put short stories on there as well. But the most popular thing on Wattpad is all different kinds of novels. And what attracts readers to it is it's free. But the readership for Wattpad is also quite young, and it's also quite international. So there's books on Wattpad in just about any language you can name. And one of the fun things about writing Feeding Frenzy when it was still on Wattpad was I could look at a map and it would show me where in the world the different readers were living. And it was everywhere. I was really surprised that only about 30% of the readers were in the United States, because that's a huge market for books in English, because there's just so many readers and it's an educated country. I had readers in India. I had readers all over Asia. I had some in Canada, a lot more in the States. I would say the biggest concentration of readers was in the United States, but they were everywhere.
That's great. I think that's a neat and interesting thing. And so for all you listeners who are out of books and need another one, well, once you finish with Feeding Frenzy, of course, run on over to Wattpad and give yourself something to do until the next episode of Coffee Shop.
Okay.
Now, back to you, Maaja. I always ask this one. What is your favorite coffee shop treat?
Okay, I love cinnamon buns, cinnamon rolls. They are addictive. They are, when you walk through a bakery or in a mall where they have cinnamon buns cooking, I just have to go there. Because when I was a kid, my grandmother would make her own cinnamon buns using scone dough, and she'd put a lot of butter and cinnamon and brown sugar and raisins, and it's so nostalgic for me to have a cinnamon bun because it reminds me of my grandmother.
Oh, that is fantastic. And cinnamon buns are right up there along with me with anything chocolate.
Oh, yeah. My husband is a huge chocolate fan. He has Rubbermaid containers of chocolate in the basement, which he calls, well, his friends call the Strategic Chocolate Reserve.
Oh, that's a good one.
I go to a lot of science fiction and fantasy conventions with Gunnar, my husband, and what he loves to do is go around helping people taste different kinds of chocolate and find out what they like best in chocolate. So he has literally held chocolate tastings for people It's one of his most endearing qualities.
Oh, a man who comes bearing chocolate? I say that's a winner on any stage.
Yeah.
Now, back to your writing. You've finished mm-hmm. book one. It's out there. You're working on book two and three. Is this yeah. going to be the end of your writing, or do you have more things you want to work on, or are you going to try traditional publishing after this, or how are you going to have fun with the next books?
Okay, so I have the three books of the Loon Lake Magic series in draft, but I'm kind of burning to get them done in a way, because I think it was last summer, I wrote a new mystery thriller about a young woman in France who realizes she has an identical twin in Buffalo, New York, and they find each other accidentally through social media, and it's kind of an instant tight friendship because they just get each other, and then the twin in Buffalo goes missing. She kind of disappears from the scene, and you know what? They had kind of quarreled a little bit, so the French twin didn't worry about it too much until the Buffalo twin's social media accounts come alive again, and she realizes that someone is impersonating her sister. So that's the scenario, and I've written it, and I'm so excited about it because it's a real mystery story. There's no magic, and I love mystery, so that's one that I would probably send a traditional publisher because I think it would appeal to a broader audience.
That's fantastic, and it still does have that coming-of-age kind of ring to it as well.
Yeah, it's the same age group. It would be first year university. The French girl is going to be going to university in the States, and she's going to do a surprise visit to her twin in Buffalo, especially after these suspicious things have happened online. So the story really takes off from that point, but I won't tell you anymore.
No, that would probably definitely be considered a spoiler, but it's great to know that you're thinking of doing the hybrid route, because I always loved one of my things about authors is I love to see how many different ways they can get the word out there and get their writing out there. And it's always fascinating, especially with all the modern social media and all those things. So has being on social media been a natural thing for you, or has it been something you've learned because of your writing?
I think starting a blog in, I think it was about 2009, where I reviewed things like movies and books, and I think I really taught myself to write better by blogging. I had a blog called Cereal Box Reader. I don't update it anymore. Everything now is on my MaajaWentz.com website. But I really do credit blogging with improving my writing because you take a certain pride in something that you know that can be read by anybody anywhere in the world, and your name is attached to it.
I think it's important to take that pride. And we were chatting off air, no surprise to anyone who's ever done a podcast. We chatted during the commercial break, and we both actually agreed one thing that makes all the difference in the book, and that was the editing, wasn't it, Maaja?
Oh, yeah. I really want to credit the editor, Sandra Kasturi. She's an award-winning editor who has her own publishing company, and I'm so fortunate that she fit Feeding Frenzy into her schedule for me because she's a friend. But she's the kind of woman who can write published poetry, and she's just an excellent editor, and she really got what my story was about. So I feel like this story went through the same stages of editing that a traditionally published book would. And you know, writing the book and having it edited by a really excellent professional editor, I credit that with improving my writing, because since writing Feeding Frenzy and polishing it, I have a story upcoming in Ellery Queen Mystery Magazine. So that's, if you want, you could call that a professional writing credit. I've always been a fan of Ellery Queen Mystery Magazine, so it's really kind of a thrill to me to know that my story, Inside of a Dog, is going to be upcoming, I believe, in the April issue.
That's fantastic. So
Yeah, I was really excited.
Hey, it's one of those, you've got to sell, and this is one thing I've heard many authors say, you've got to celebrate the small victories as well as the large ones.
Yeah, well, I consider this interview a celebration, Jesse. I really, really want to thank you for having me on, because it's not every day you get to talk about what makes you excited creatively. I have a job as a teacher librarian, and my job is to facilitate the learning of other people. I'm a facilitator. Most of my day is not about me. It's about other people. And I really enjoy that. I really love my job. I love being surrounded by books. I love getting kids excited about reading and learning. But I also feel spoiled to sit down and talk to you about nothing but creativity and writing.
Well, then you'll probably love one of my favorite sayings. Reading is the only addiction I'll feed.
Okay, I love that.
I have given books and Kindles, and it's one of my top all-time gifts. And I've given them to children as young as 7 and 8.
Yeah, it's never too young to teach them to chew on one of those lovely board books.
Exactly. And when you take an 8 or 9-year-old who's going to be moving all over the country because his parents are in the military, and you go, here, I started you an Amazon account. Here's this device. And it is filled with 300 books. You go have fun. And of course, you give his parents all the access information. And
what a fantastic idea. What a great idea. I wish more parents would do that, actually, because it doesn't matter how big your school library is. It's never going to be big enough to have everything that a child wants.
And this way also, especially because I always look at it from the military perspective, because, well, that's kind of my world. This way, that child, the parents never have to worry about the weight of those books. They will never have to worry, do we have to get rid of book Y because we're moving? Because it weighs ounces. And
yeah.
How much room is it going to take up on their move? Not much. They can throw it in the car with the kid.
And books are such a good refuge. Like, if you are moving often, books make really good friends while you're making new ones.
They do. I was one of those kids. Even as a kid, I had my nose in a book.
Yeah, I was that kid too. I was the kid that my parents would, on a nice sunny day, kick me out. They'd say, go outside, because I would just want to read and read and read.
Oh, well, I'd just take the book outside with me.
Oh, no, if I went outside, I was going to play with my friends. I wasn't going to attempt to read.
Oh, no, I was the one that was taking the book outside with me.
Wow, that must have made swimming difficult.
I can't tell you how many sandy and wet books I had as a kid and teenager, because I grew up near the ocean.
Oh my gosh, you're right. Reading at the beach is such a fun thing to do.
So, all right, what of your favorite foods? Let's get back to Feeding Frenzy. Of your favorite foods, is there one that you just had to put in Feeding Frenzy just because of the fun of it or because of your love for it?
Oh, absolutely. There's an early scene in Feeding Frenzy where Roberto is starting to feel that unnatural hunger, but he's also homesick because his parents have basically banished him to this small Canadian city to, you know, and he misses his friends and he misses being at the beach. And so he is missing empanadas. And so I describe how he loves opening the empanadas and spritzing them with lime. He misses papas la huancaina, which is potatoes in yellow sauce. It's a very typical Peruvian dish. He misses the food of home. And this is something I felt as well, because I've done a couple of exchanges to France, learning French, going to school in France. And one of the things that I really missed was my mother's cooking. So I wanted to have that feeling that he was missing home. He was missing home cooking. But of course, he would have had a cook. He would never have had his mother's food, probably.
Well, that sounds like a blast.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and I just forgot the question I was going to ask. Oh, back to editing. They say editing is slaying your darlings. Was there something you had to take out of the book, a scene, a character, some little thing you had to take out of the book that you just loved, but you had to do it to make the story stronger?
Actually, no, I'm a very sparse writer. I like to write fiction that's very pacey, page-turny. So a lot of the editing of this story was putting in the details of landscape, putting in the details of geography, describing things, because nobody likes to read a story that doesn't give you a sense of place. But for me, it's the actions, it's the people, it's the dialogue, it's the excitement that is most important. So no, I didn't have to cut anything really. I put more in to improve the book.
That's great. That's great. Because I've also had authors that had to cut characters, had to cut chapters, or even a scene. And some of them have loved it, and some of them that, no, I was just fine with doing so. So it's always something I like to ask.
Yeah, I added a lot. I even added the ending. So when I started editing the book, I was working towards an ending that I was still figuring out in a way. And once I had the ending, everything really came together a lot better.
That's great. I mean, isn't the ending always the best part?
It is. It is. It's and it was so much fun not knowing exactly how that final scene would go down, where basically, Tanya is not your classic kick-ass heroine with fighting skills. And yet, she's up against a big bad who can use magic, who can control people's minds, who can slip in and out of different identities. And somehow, she has to defeat him in the hospital room where her aunt is actually on the verge of having a very crucial operation that if she doesn't get it, she will die. So Tanya goes from being the person who gets bullied in high school to the person who can stand up to the threat to the whole town, the threat to normality, and the threat to, you know, keeping magic under control.
That's great that you were able to include such drama in your story.
Yeah, I love the drama. It's no fun without the drama.
No, it never is. What advice would you give to someone who's always sitting there going, I'd love to write a book. I want to write a book. I don't know where to start. Because not everybody's going to have time to go out and get a degree or take a class. So what little bit of advice would you give them?
Okay, if they're a big reader, they have studied the structure of novels and characters their whole life. So if this person is a big reader and they've read a lot of books, I would say learning can come from doing. I mean, I wrote the first draft of my very first novel without any instruction at all in how to write a novel in 6 weeks over the course of a summer. Now, I had just graduated from university, so you could call that a cheat. But I think it comes from doing even more than studying. And the other thing is, if this person is saying, well, I would do it, but I've got a family. I would do it, but I don't have time. They could do what I did if they're really serious, which is to get up at 5 or as early as they have to and work every day before they go to work. NaNoWriMo is a great inspiration for that kind of thing. I've done NaNoWriMo a few times. It's called National Novel Writing Month. And the idea is that you will write roughly 2,000 words a day for 30 days. And at the end of that time, you have a novel. And by setting yourself a quota of words, but not holding yourself to any kind of standard of perfection, you will get from the beginning to the end, and then you can learn to revise. It's kind of like on-the-job training.
Well, I do have to let the listeners know that I am a supporter of NaNoWriMo. Don't ask me to write. I'm not going to do it. Nope, I'll stay behind the microphone. But on my website, jessiescoffeeshop.com, there is a chat room. Now, it is open year-round, but it is geared for writers in NaNoWriMo. And it's there for virtual write-ins or just chit-chatting with other authors. I have told my wordsmiths I will leave it up unless it becomes a problem.
Oh, that's great to have that resource. If it's a chat room, one thing that people who are doing NaNoWriMo like to do is hold writing sprints. I've done writing sprints with people that I may never meet in person, but virtually you just get online on the chat room and say, okay, let's write for the next half hour. And in half an hour, we'll get back on and see how many words we wrote. It's kind of a low stress way of encouraging each other.
Exactly. And I started it because, like I said, I'm not a writer, but I seem to be friends. They seem to be all around me. Now, of course, they're all always trying to get me to write, but I always keep going, nope, not going to happen. But I'll have you on the coffee shop when your book comes out.
I never say never. What about nonfiction?
No, thanks.
Wow. Okay.
I have.
But I mean, interviewing people makes you automatically a journalist. You know that, right?
Yes, and I have tried and tried and tried. And the running joke among my writer friends is, well, skip the writing, just do the audiobook.
Oh, that's great.
Because I have tried to actually sit down and type out words. I get about 2,000 to 3,000 words in, and I may do this even for 3 or 4 days running. But to me, it feels like I'm being tortured. Now you put me behind the microphone and my eyes light up and suddenly I'm having fun.
Don't write a novel. Just keep what you're doing. I think it's wonderful.
Like I said, somebody's got to talk to you guys.
Thank you.
All right. So with that great advice in hand and presumably a cinnamon bun waiting in the wing, what is your social media contact information?
Oh, thanks, Jesse. So I have a website at mayawentz.com, and I will spell that because my name is difficult. MAAJAWENTZ.com. I'm on Twitter, the same thing, at mayawentz. And of course, I'm on Amazon. You could search for Feeding Frenzy, or you could spell my name out again in the search bar. But yeah, I'd love people to contact me via Twitter. I have a Facebook, which you could search for my name as well, but it's just getting started because I'm really comfortable with Twitter, and I don't mind doing the odd thing on YouTube. But really, I would rather just write books and write stories and write the occasional post for my blog.
Well, I thank you very much, Maaja, and we have come to my favorite time of the show. Yeah, Maaja and that copy of Feeding Frenzy, but first, I must remind all of you, if you want to track me down, you can find me on Twitter at Radio Host Jesse. You can email me at the station at Jesse, J-E-S-S-I-E, at KLRNRadio.com. And of course, don't forget to check out jessiescoffeeshop.com. Now, I'm going to pour myself a fresh cup of coffee and snatch that copy of Feeding Frenzy off the table and settle down into the pages of a great book. And I will see you folks next time in the coffee shop.